In the first lecture, I commented on the philosophical school of phenomenology and focused especially on the concept of intentionality. It refers to the fact that our consciousness is always conscious of something directed toward subject matter, and the subject matter might be imagined, fantasized, or perceived, or whatever. Radically, or speaking more radically than this trivial insight, one could say that one effect of this insight is that our consciousness is also somehow a secondary effect of what it is conscious of. It becomes too late with regard to its self-reflexivity, as self-reflexivity is a later self-relation of consciousness towards itself that is preceded by bodily experiences in its everyday contact with objects of all kinds and states of affairs of all kinds and facts of all kinds. Consciousness is a secondary effect of what it is conscious of. It is never untouched by the life world it is surrounded by, but rather, as I just said, the effect of it. Today, Heidegger's book, Being and Time, will be my main focus of my talk because, as we will see, Heidegger takes up the concept of intentionality and adapts it for the presentation of his own understanding of subjectivity, and he calls this own almost idiosyncratic form of subjectivity Dasein. So let's start and dive directly into the book. Heidegger begins Being and Time with a rather odd question because he asks what the true meaning of the word being is supposed to be. And his thesis is that this question of being, or that the question of being, does not only sound odd, but the fact that it sounds odd proves that being as a philosophical topic has been profoundly neglected, even for centuries. And that's why Heidegger writes, almost cynically, this question, so the question of being, has today been forgotten, even though in our time we deem it progressive to give our approval to metaphysics again. So if metaphysics is the discipline that seeks to reveal and uncover the basic structures of reality, the basic structures of what there is, very generally speaking, then it must be in a bad state if it has lost the question of being. But obviously that sounds a little bit odd, so one could, or one has to ask, how can Heidegger even say such a bizarre thing? That the question of being has been neglected, or that being as a philosophical question has been neglected. Philosophy, at least since Plato, has always been about analyzing the basic structures of reality through asking how we, for example, recognize certain states of affairs, or with regard to which concepts we recognize certain affairs. And Plato's answer and Plato's philosophy of analyzing philosophical concepts is one of his most famous theories, of course, the theory of eternal forms as some kind of interface our mind plugs into as these eternal forms or eternal ideas, universals, help our minds to organize our beliefs in a world of constant change. And Plato's student Aristotle mentions famously in his Metaphysics that being can be said in many ways, depending on the ontological status of entities we refer to. They can be abstract, like numbers, middle-sized, like this desk in front of me, or imagined like a unicorn. And scholastic philosophers like Thomas Aquinas add the general and abstract term being to the so-called transcendental categories, unum, verum, bonum, aliquid, ens. They are all basic concepts to define the existence of an entity. So how can Heidegger say such a bizarre thing, to pretend that the question of being has not been posed correctly? But also we human beings, we use the concept being in multiple forms when we talk about houses, trees, as I said, abstract numbers, or even purely imaginative entities like Superman or Sherlock Holmes. In all these cases, we have absolutely no problem of adapting the word being or the word existence in multiple occasions and in multiple propositions. So what is exactly the question of being for Heidegger all about, that he can tell us that the concept of being has lost its meaning and that philosophers have forgotten its basic importance? The problem Heidegger identifies is obviously not a problem of grammar or of the etymological origin of the word being. The question of being is also not a question regarding the meaning of our life or something like that. Well, let's talk about the meaning of life or the meaning of being, which is our life. Heidegger is not in that sense the founding father of New Age spirituality, though sometimes one has the impression that his writings have a tone of New Age spirituality. Rather, the question of being implies, if posed correctly and broken down into its basic moments, the existential self-understanding of the human being to him or to herself. And I will try to explain this in more detail. But before we go into this argument, so that the question of being only makes sense with regard to the existence of Dasein, of the very special form that we human beings incorporate, before we go into this detail, I would like to note that Heidegger writes being and time also with the tone of a dramatic urgency that you may have experienced yourself while reading, for example, the introduction. We are told from the very beginning that being and time sets a new beginning, a new philosophical beginning. And we are familiar with such radical beginnings from philosophers like Descartes, Kant, Nietzsche, and Wittgenstein. Proclaiming a new beginning is always about settling accounts with the past and questioning the blindness of the philosophical zeitgeist with regard to its poor conditions or with regards to its underdetermined categories. A previous tradition of thought is convicted of its insuitability due to the categorical mistakes inherent in its justification. And this then again justifies the radical philosopher to override this tradition by the necessity of a new beginning. And Heidegger truly strives with being and time for this kind of initiation, this kind of radical new beginning. And in that sense, he is quite familiar or similar to Nietzsche and Wittgenstein, because he too proclaims a new beginning of philosophy in the name of phenomenology, the philosophical school that was founded by Edmund Husserl, but not brought to its radical fulfillment that Heidegger has to deliver. This radicality reminded me of the Matrix movie, and please allow me to make this short digression. You might know the famous scene of the Matrix movie in which a character called Morpheus presents to the movie's hero Neo two pills. He tells him that if he takes the red pill, he will break out of a tissue of lies and enter a realm of truth that he will no longer be able to control and from which he will not be able to return. And this kind of either-or option is also present in Heidegger's book. Because if the neglected question of being is exposed in its true meaning, and that's Heidegger's project, then according to Heidegger, nothing is as it was before. A certain or an essential or an unquestioned philosophical tradition becomes completely invalid, and a false relationship to the world will be destroyed or could be destroyed. And truly, this is not entirely without danger, for according to Heidegger, the so-called subject of the Occident, das abendländische Subjekt, will experience a destabilization of which one will ask whether it is any good for the subject at all. And that is exactly the question that is still asked today by critics of Heidegger, from Jürgen Habermas to Ernst Tugendhat. They make Heidegger's philosophy not only prone to authoritarian politics, or they declare Heidegger's philosophy not only prone to authoritarian politics, the Nazi regime, which Heidegger was obviously a member of or participated in willingly, but they make being and time co-responsible also for postmodern philosophy associated stereotypically with moral and epistemic relativism. And especially the philosophy of Derrida was criticized in the German academic world repeatedly of being a victim somehow also of Heidegger's philosophy. Heidegger's work was obviously discovered first in France and laid the foundations for philosophers like Jacques Derrida, Immanuel Levinas, and Merleau-Ponty and others. But we will get to that later on. For now, I'm just trying to give you an idea of the drama and existential urgency with which Heidegger introduces this work. As I said, for Heidegger, the true understanding of being has been neglected, and he mentions three examples of this denial, of this neglection of the question of being. And let's go briefly through these three arguments. The first example of the denial of the question of being is that being is the most universal notion or concept, and as such simply void of meaning. And Heidegger refers for this interpretation of being to Aristotle's Metaphysics and to the Summa of Thomas Aquinas to prove it. He quotes, for example, Thomas, and Thomas writes, "An understanding of being is already included in conceiving anything which one apprehends as an entity. So I don't have to reflect on being, because when I use an expression, a state of affairs where being is, for example, the copula, then the meaning of being is obvious to me. The question of the meaning of being is therefore literally superfluous," so Heidegger's critique. Heidegger, I quote, "It is said that being is the most universal and the emptiest of concepts. As such, it resists every attempt at definition. Nor does this most universal and hence undefinable concept require any definition, for everyone uses it constantly and already understands what he means by it." Heidegger here criticizes a tradition which says that asking for the meaning of being is actually making a category mistake. If I use the word being in a sentence, then being is nothing more than the copula between subject and predicate, or the copula which glues together subject and predicate. For example, the table is brown. In this proposition, the word being has a grammatical significance. It is, the table is brown. There's nothing special about being or about is. It is the copula that connects a particular object, in this case, the table, to a universal property in the form of a judgment. The table is brown. Being as copula simply enables us to predicate something of something. But to ask about being beyond this meaning in the sentence structure is somehow absurd for, let's say, for the layman or the laywoman. For we have no conception of it. Kant would say we are making a category mistake. He says explicitly, being or existence is not a predicate. That's the Kant quote. That means it cannot be said of something like an additional property. For example, things can be brown, they can be big, or they can be defective, but I cannot say the chair is brown and in addition it has existence. I can say the chair is not at my desk, meaning the chair is not where I expected it to be. But imagine that I step into my office and then I tell to you or tell to a friend, "Well, this is my new chair." Did you realize it is not only brown, but it also has existence or it has being? That would be rather absurd. My friend wouldn't know what I'm supposed to say with this property of existence with regard to the chair or to the table. Things can be brown, they can be defective, but they cannot have an additional property of existence. I hope you see the point that Kant is making when he says that existence is not a predicate, that it is not a property of something. To talk this way is misleading, since I objectify existence or being as something that the chair participates in. But Heidegger is not satisfied with this kind of negation of the question of being. He says, on the contrary, the concept of being remains within this tradition of philosophy the darkest of all. And in a way, he truly wants to reverse Kant's thesis that existence is not a predicate. Heidegger wants to show, yes, existence is a predicate, and exactly that's what has been lost. The second denial of the question of being sounds like this. The term being is undefinable because of the formality of its supreme universality. Heidegger writes, "Being cannot be derived from higher concepts by definition, nor can it be presented by lower ones. So the generality of being is not that of a concept. It is useless to classify. If I tell you, bring me," and that's an example, "if I tell you, bring me a being thing, you would not know what to bring me because you could show me anything. You could tell me, well, I'll just bring you a thought because now I can tell you what I'm thinking. Or you could say, I'm bring you this, this chair or this table, or I bring you an abstract number. As such, being is not is no help of classification, as for example the concept mammal helps us to differentiate zoological species. Being is simply too general to perform this task of making a difference, which is a difference. According to the traditional method of definition, one needs genus proximum and the differentia specifica, but we cannot say being measures 5 meters and weighs 3 kilograms, or being is rational and belongs like man to a subclass of the class of mammals. But Heidegger also rejects this theory of being as trivial. The only thing that is clear is the fact that being cannot have the character of an entity. And that's also for Heidegger obvious. Thus, the logic of definition is not applicable to being, but as I said before, the notion of being may be undefined, but that doesn't mean that we can put it aside. And here comes the third denial of the question of being. Being is the most self-evident concept, since it is used in all kinds of judgment. It carries no weight, no thought. So you see, all these three arguments are rather similar. Everyone understands sentences such as "the sky is blue" or "I am happy." But even here, if all this is true, the self-evidence remains completely undefined. Our daily use of the verb to be truly shows that we have a pre-reflexive understanding of being, but that does not eliminate the fact, so Heidegger, that the real sense of being is still veiled in darkness. And Heidegger thinks it is, and this is why being has to be rediscovered as a concept for a truly metaphysical investigation. So, after revealing that the philosophical tradition has thus trivialized the question of being, or the quest for being, the philosophical quest for being to understand being correctly, Heidegger now wants to expose something like a formal structure in the quest for a metaphysical understanding of being itself. And he claims that the circumstance alone of searching for a determination of the meaning of being refers us automatically to something which in the investigation must also exist as that which is pursued. Therefore, the meaning of being cannot be completely hidden from us in darkness, because even the quest for being has its own character of being, end quote. In other words, being is that which urges us human beings to look out for its deeper meaning. I admit that this argument sounds odd and mystic, because if I want to know if the spaghetti or if a spaghetti monster exists somewhere in the universe, my quest for the spaghetti monster does not presuppose the spaghetti monster to which I'm drawn or to which I'm related intentionally. But this is obviously not what Heidegger has in mind, because our quest would be directed to something that exists in space and time, the spaghetti monster. He rather underlines that being remains an existential itch of human beings, since human beings lack a final understanding of their own human being. And so it's rather through the fact that being is not something that we can put in front of us, like I can put a microphone in front of me, that we are always in this kind of relation with something that is missing, because it is already inscribed somehow in our metaphysical DNA as human and reasonable beings. His basic idea here is actually quite simple. He wants to say that searching for the meaning of being already brings something of being to the fore, but at least for a human being, obviously not for an animal. Because by asking the question about the meaning of being in the first place, we find ourselves in a certain relationship to that which is interrogated, das Befragte, and that is being. And this is, so to speak, his first thesis in the second paragraph. And I present you here the important quote. The meaning of being must already be available to us in some way. We always conduct our activities in an understanding of being. Out of this understanding arises the explicit question of the meaning of being. And moreover, he says, the being of entities is not itself an entity, obviously. So being is not something similar to this microphone, to the lamp, to a chair. That means one cannot determine the meaning of being by tracing entities back and their origin to some other entities, as if being had the character of some possible entity, End of quote. Being is not an entity like chairs, like houses, numbers, or properties are, for being is, as I already said, itself no being. It is not an object that I can pick out in the world and put in front of me, or whose essence I can pin down with the help of an encyclopedic definition. Being is also not a universal like the color red, or the form of a triangle, or a virtue like bravery is a universal. All these universals have particulars they are instantiated in, but being is too universal for being one property among others. Therefore, the access to being cannot be granted with the help of an epistemological system, let's say in the tradition of Kant's theoretical or practical philosophy. Kant's help us understand how our objective knowledge has its source in both the mind and the senses. But as I said, for Kant, being itself is a senseless concept if it wants to carry more than its function in a predicate like the one when I say the chair is brown. There is no special central receptivity of being which allows me to make reasonable claims about the concept being. Objects in space and time adopt what Kant calls the category of substance, but Kant uses the concept, or the very traditional concept of substance, in a rather nominalistic and not realistic Platonic meaning. The concept substance is only adopted to explain that an object of experience endures in time to be experienced at all, but there is neither a substrate which binds the particular properties of a chair together, nor is there a universal substance in which the individual participates metaphysically, like in being as the set of all sets, or the entire horizons of meaning somehow granted, let's say, by being or by God or by some kind of metaphysical entity. So to make a long story short, the only way of access to being, of which Heidegger speaks of, must be that of phenomenology, but only if it supplies the analysis of being with regard to the human condition of existence called Dasein. Heidegger invents the concept Dasein because he does not want to talk about us human beings as subjects, since every subject talk presupposes indirectly the subject-object dichotomy, so the fact that I'm here the subject and the outside world is around me. So Dasein is supposed to be an antidote to subject-object talk, at least that's the way I understand it. It's rather trivial, but I see the point he wants to make. Therefore, strictly speaking, it neither means Homo sapiens or Anima Rationale nor Res Cogitans, the thinking thing. Dasein is rather the human being in an eternal suspense of its meaning and of its fate. And the way it is one of the basic arguments, or one of multiple arguments that Heidegger presents in Being and Time. Maybe this famous painting by René Magritte might help us symbolically to understand what Heidegger is aiming at with regard to this talk of Dasein. We see a man in front of a mirror, but instead of looking himself in the eyes, he only sees his head from behind. And allegorically speaking, I would say, Dasein never gets in true confrontation with itself. And one reason for this is that we have no access to the cultural and, for example, the cultural and social context which shaped our identity from birth onwards. In this sense, we are confronted not only with the opaqueness of our own genealogy from birth onwards, for example, to today, but also with the opaqueness of what Richard Dawkins calls memes in a famous book from 1976 in comparison to genes. And memes are something like the cultural data units that shape multiple layers of our background knowledge, without us having always access to the conditions of this background knowledge. This fact obviously distinguishes us from creatures in the animal kingdom who cannot even get an idea of what it could mean to be confronted with opaqueness in the midst of one's identity. So in order to start an investigation with regard to the question of being, it makes, according to Heidegger, no sense to look around the world and contemplate all kinds of things. Instead, one has to analyze Dasein and the way things appear and relate to Dasein, because it is man, it is man, him and herself that is always already self-reflectively related to being in its form of appearing. This chair or this desk here in front of me, this speaker's desk here in front of me is not related to being. And my cat, if I would have one, would neither be related to being, simply because the chair or this speaker's desk is, as Heidegger says elsewhere, without a world, weltlos, and the cat, like any animal, is poor in the world, weltarm. But Dasein is worldly, as such it is Heidegger's medium to get into analysis of being. As I said, we are not on track of an epistemological investigation, like Kant's Critique of Pure Reason, or Hegel's Phenomenology of Spirit, where the subject-object dichotomy is either interpreted in Kant's work with a priori principles of cognition and their relation to sense data, or with regard, in Hegel, to a teleological process through world stages within time. Dasein does not describe an inwardness that we associate, for example, with self-absorption of, or with meditation. Dasein has nothing to do with an intellectual contemplation in which, like in a mystic moment, the world of phenomena vanishes. Rather, Dasein is a concept that shows us the permanent projection of ourselves to the outside world, which has already had its effect on us in our consciousness, before we are aware of this interrelatedness. There is no protective fortress of inwardness where Dasein is completely in a harmonious relation with itself. It is rather the opposite. The very fact that Dasein turns away from any understanding of a subject's inwardness means that it is defined by a permanent projection onto the outside world and inflicted by negativity by that which it is not. Consciousness is a permanent movement of intentionality toward what the individual subject is not, but through which the individual subject is obviously affected by. Dasein describes our human condition as extimacy in opposition to intimacy. By the way, this is one of the central theses that Sartre in Being and Nothingness presents in 1943. For Sartre, consciousness is a nothing that is bound to permanent intentionality. Sartre will define consciousness as le manque d'être, as lack of being. But this is precisely what creates also for Heidegger a new problem for Dasein. It tends to surrender to the outside world, and Heidegger explicitly says so, and it becomes also obvious that Søren Kierkegaard is one of his sources in this context. He writes, Dasein always understands itself in terms of its existence, in terms of a possibility of itself, to be itself or not itself. Dasein has either chosen these possibilities itself, or got itself into them, or grown up in them already. Only the particular Dasein decides its existence, whether it does so by taking hold or by neglecting it, end of quote. Heidegger describes here Dasein as being always in a paradoxical, almost Hamlet-like state of mind, to be itself and not to be itself. Dasein is, in other words, similar to an empty set of existence that is in a permanent state of tension with a virtual image of its own authenticity, to be itself, and with the outside world it is intertwined with, that can manipulate this authenticity not to be itself. At first glance, this outside world surrounding us in everyday life appears to be absolutely legitimate. It represents legal structures of all kinds that have been set by tradition, and in which we play our customary roles as subjects. But it is precisely here that Dasein can feel confronted with an existential threat to be itself, because Dasein can lose itself to traditions, since it is thrown into time without somehow granting or being sure of what its own existence is supposed to be about. Not only is Dasein inclined to fall back upon its world, the world in which it is, and to interpret itself in terms of that world by its reflected light, but also Dasein simultaneously falls prey to the tradition of which it has more or less explicitly taken hold. This tradition keeps it from providing its own guidance, whether in inquiring or in choosing, end of quote. So tradition confers, very generally speaking, identity on Dasein, obviously, but it can also obscure Dasein possibilities. By definition, it disguises its own legitimacy and can be a barrier on a path to authenticity. Heidegger here is not so much the reactionary fool Thomas Bernhard makes fun of in his novels in a really hilarious and great way. This love of tradition and homeland cliché is truly present in many of Heidegger's works, but in this analysis of existence one can find an exposure of the contingency of traditions that Dasein is inclined to forget, and here we have a true critique, a Heideggerian critique of all tradition talk. And in that sense, Heidegger's philosophy is truly radical. He questions traditions at the most existential level of Dasein's existence. In that sense, he describes Dasein as an existence in a zone of practical but also epistemological indeterminacy. And in this sense, his analysis fits perfectly the zeitgeist of his epoch, the time of what is known as 20th century modernity. For it is precisely in the era, starting with the Fin des Siècles and having its cultural combination in between the two world wars, especially in the Weimar Republic, that the supposed legitimacy of outdated traditional models of society, like state, family, church, trade unions, nobility, are radically called into question throughout Europe. You can see the effects of this in modern art and, for example, in the novels of the modern age, from Robert Musil's Man Without Qualities to Marcel Proust's A la Recherche du Temps Perdu and the heroes of Franz Kafka's text. And I have here some images from a famous movie, The Trial, directed by Orson Welles. And it is especially Kafka's characters that somehow exemplify Dasein in Heidegger's interpretation, since Kafka's characters are always driven by the question of their role in social structures that have lost their traditional legitimacy. Think of the novels The Trial and The Castle. The helplessness of Kafka's figure is the helplessness, allegorically speaking, of Dasein in Heidegger's tradition, which strives for the fulfillment of its symbolic mandate, which is no longer understood or guaranteed, even symbolically guaranteed, because these institutions become perverse through economization and administration. Kafka's characters hear an appeal, they hear an order or a condemnation, as in the novel The Trial, but they no longer understand the context of this kind of appeal. I mentioned this cultural context of the beginning of the 20th century, since Heidegger's Being and Time is in part a seismographic analysis of a new understanding of subjectivity in a time where symbolic machines of meaning, purpose, and transcendence are failing. There's a famous debate between Walter Benjamin and Gershom Scholem that I mentioned already in other lectures on this aspect of tradition, which Scholem describes as having, so the traditions, as having validity without metaphysical meaning. So traditions are also granted from generations to generations, but they have lost their true meaning. That were enrooted in traditions themselves. And the Hungarian philosopher George Lucas will develop the thesis that from the early modern period onwards, 16th century, the beginning of the novel, to the modern age, the paradigm of metaphysical homelessness has finally emerged in its true radicality. This image of metaphysical homelessness also fits, I think, very well Heidegger's analysis of Dasein, because this Dasein has no relation to God in the traditional sense, or to church, or to the state. It is truly a meditation on a contentless structure of subjectivity. Dasein exists in an intermediate realm of possibility and virtuality, which Heidegger himself has left underdetermined. This becomes clear later on in these introductory lectures when we focus on the chapters on anxiety, on care or worry, Sorge, or when we talk about Heidegger's calls, the wish to have a conscience. Heidegger's Daseins analysis can therefore be understood as the meta-theory of subjectivity turned hysterical at the beginning of the 20th century. This expresses the following quote: Dasein is its past, whether explicitly or not. And this is not so only in that its past is, as it were, pushing itself along behind it, and that Dasein possesses what is past as a property which is still present at hand and which sometimes has effects, after effects upon it. Dasein is its past in the way of its own being, which, to put it roughly, historizes out of its future on each occasion. Existence is always already born into a certain interpretation of Dasein. We do not enter a mathematically rational space in the world. We enter the world in a symbolic order, which then serves as the basis of our own subsequent interpretations of ourselves within the symbolic order, with all the historical burden inscribed into the universe, into the historical context we live in. But by revealing this structure, Heidegger is already destabilizing this understanding because it is no longer an unproblematic or obvious understanding. Thus, existence or Dasein is exposed to the danger of surrendering itself to tradition, though at first say we would say, well, tradition is great, but Heidegger says, no, tradition is totally ambivalent. If Dasein unquestioningly merges into the cultural space into which it is born, then, according to Heidegger, it is always in danger of surrendering the guidance over its own questions and its own choice of life to this tradition, and that is somehow not what he would prefer. This is why, as Heidegger writes, that Dasein is inclined to fall back upon its world, the world in which it is, and to interpret itself in terms of that world by its reflected light. And by the way, this is a reproach that Heidegger will lance towards a whole generation of philosophers, not only because they have missed the question of being, because he would say that the question of being has already been missing or misinterpreted with the generation of Greek philosophers, starting with Plato. And Heidegger is the one who somehow will revive a pre-Platonic interpretation of being, so that humanity, with the help of Heidegger, has the ability to get into a new relation through what existence is all about. And this is always a relation in which Sein as an enigmatic entity plays a role. So tradition clogs up the horizon of possible existence with what it presents to us as natural and legitimate. In that sense, traditions advocate what has proven to be legitimate, but traditions are only legitimate because they say so, and Heidegger says this has to be questioned philosophically, and it has to be questioned especially with regard to the history of philosophy and the history of thought in general, especially with regard to the concept of being.